In this episode of Drinking Made Easy, we'll blow through the Windy City. I'll have a $200 martini, drink in Al Capone's old hangout, and catch a ball game. It's Drinking Made Easy, Chicago. I'm Zane Lamprey. My job is to drink. I'm traveling the country with my buddies Mark Ryan and Steve McKenna as we explore the local drinking cultures, customs, and cocktails. Along the way, we'll soak in the local flavor in an effort to make drinking easy. Just outside of Chicago is the Chicago Indoor Speedway. I'm a big proponent of responsible drinking. If you're gonna drink, don't be an ass and get behind the wheel of a car, even if it's a real small one. So before we headed out on our drinking adventure, we went to do some kart racing for another six-pack challenge.
This is a rare occasion. It's morning, and we're on the show, and we have not yet been drinking. We're gonna go head-to-head.
Race.
So who are you picking?
It's kind of a flip of the coin bet. I'm just gonna go with Steve.
You feel bad for me?
I think you feel bad for him.
I feel bad.
I love you, Mark.
It's time for the six-pack challenge.
So here's the deal. In every episode of Drinking Made Easy, Steve and I will face off in a six-pack challenge. We'll bet six-packs on the outcome, and Mark will bet on who he thinks will win. Whoever wins the challenge gets six-packs of beer.
In today's six-pack challenge, Lamprey will race McKenna around the track six times. Whoever takes the checkered flag drives away with a six-pack victory. It's a rolling start, McKenna looks confused, and Lamprey jumps into the lead. These karts can reach a top speed of 35 miles per hour, so it's easy for them to get squirrely and lose traction on the turns. Lamprey, in the angry dinosaur helmet, continues to ward off McKenna. Lap two, and McKenna's having a hard time getting around Lamprey. In lap three, McKenna and the white helmet is losing patience. He keeps bumping Lamprey from behind. Lap four, and here comes McKenna. He's making his move. Oh, and he takes Lamprey out. A cheap move, but that's what Lamprey gets for hogging the course. In lap five, McKenna gets cocky and spins out. Lamprey doesn't see him, and with no reverse, Lamprey has to make a 360 just to get back on the track. But by that time, McKenna is already on his way. It's lap six, the last lap, and Lamprey's hopes for winning are in the dust. McKenna wins the six-pack challenge.
Cheers.
Upstairs, there's a full bar and restaurant.
That's Goose Island 312.
Oh, yeah?
It's made here. We're gonna learn about it today.
But once you have anything to drink, you can't race for the rest of the day.
It takes a lot of that.
No more competing, okay?
So after some beer and food, we split up to canvas the city.
Yes! You have to go eat a pizza, and you gotta go someplace and learn about stuff. We gotta go. Come on. We gotta go.
My next location was a hangout of the notorious Chicagoan Al Capone. During Prohibition, it was a speakeasy. But before that, it was a Chicago hotspot.
At one point, the Green Mill was this entire block, this jazz mecca.
Oh, yeah. Wow. So it wasn't like this.
This room did exist as the cocktail lounge.
There was like a theater part to it as well.
Yeah, yeah. There was dancing, there was like big band stuff. And yeah, this is where you'd come and like, you know, either wait for a table in a restaurant or just hang out with your date and, you know, watch the ladies sing behind the bar.
So in the 20s, that's when it was still a fun place to go, but you couldn't get booze here.
Yeah, well.
That probably destroyed. Technically.
Technically. A woman named Texas Guinan ran it for the first part of Prohibition.
Okay.
And she's famous. I mean, she would run joints in New York and New Orleans. Actually, it's Star Trek The Next Generation.
Yes.
The bartender Guinan.
Yeah, Whoopi Goldberg.
Yeah, Whoopi was her nickname. She would say she doesn't sell booze, she just rents glasses. So whenever she would get busted, which she often did, she would say, you know, and she was a cute little thing, from what I understand, and she'd just like, and they'd put the handcuffs on her, and she'd show up in front of the judge and just be all doe-eyed, and they'd let her go.
Wow. This was also, there's significance to this booth as well.
This was where Al Capone would sit when he would come in.
Okay.
Because you could see both doors.
There's something that you guys drink here that you were telling me about before we started shooting.
Something that's really significant about not just Chicago, but this place is how much we drink Malort here.
Now this is?
Jepson's Malort, yeah.
Jepson's Malort from Carl Jepson Company, Chicago.
Yeah.
Jepson's Malort, written on the bottle, has the aroma and full-bodied flavor of an unusual botanical. Its bitter taste is savored by two-fisted drinkers.
Yeah, the little tag that would come with the bottle would say, are you man enough for a two-fisted drink? One out of 50 people who try this will ever drink it again.
Okay. Let's see.
Now, I'll tell you after.
Okay. Unprepared I was.
Oh wait, the taste keeps going.
Yeah, it's not stopping.
No,
not what the hell is that?
Best description I've ever heard was grapefruit juice and hairspray. Not any kind of fancy hairspray.
Oh,
I'm talking like
that's exactly what it is.
The house special is a shot of Malort with a chaser of Schlitz.
In 2007, when we celebrated our 100-year anniversary, that's what was the special was.
So it was this. It was Schlitz.
Yep, Schlitz and a shot of Malort.
What's the significance to Chicago?
You drive around, you see a lot of old buildings, most of them aren't even bars anymore, with the Schlitz emblem built into the stonework of the building. During the Great Depression, people couldn't afford to open bars. So Schlitz would make a deal with them, you know, and then they would put in the Schlitz emblem and help them build it, and they would have to promise to just sell Schlitz.
Wow.
And you'd be amazed at the number of buildings that there still are. I mean, you can't drive like 10 blocks, really, on the north side without seeing one.
Really?
Yeah.
Like built into the stonework
of it? Yeah, absolutely.
Wow. So is it like a chaser?
No, really, it'll cut through just about anything.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Unless you're chasing with turpentine, you're still gonna chase the Malort.
All right.
Cheers.
Cheers. Yep. Oh yeah, I made it through. Awesome.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, a rooftop martini. Drinking Made Easy isn't just a TV show, it's also a drinking game.
Yeah.
So you can actually play along at home. You can drink along with us. For example, rule number one, if you're the first person to see Pleiplius hiding somewhere in the show or out in the open, you can make someone else drink. Rule number two, if we mess up on our continuity, something's not quite the same from one shot to the next, you get to make someone drink. Rule number three, when we challenge each other, pick a side. If you lose, you drink. To have these rules explained, and for more drinking rules of the show, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. Oh, please, you have to drink.
Yeah.
I'm drinking my way through Chicago, and my next stop is on the rooftop of the upscale Tavern at the Park to try their pricey Cloudgate Martini based on the sculpture in Millennium Park.
Could I be a patron in your restaurant
You're
dressed like
really
this?
You're not really the target market for this drink.
Who is the target market?
Actually, you are the target market.
It's a $200 drink.
Yes.
So the joke was, the dress like this, I'm not your demographic, but I have a television show, so clearly, oh, maybe I am someone that is in the ballpark of the realm. The drink is a $200 martini.
It is.
And there's a twist.
There is a twist.
So let's make it, and then we'll reveal the twist in the
end. Let's do it.
Well, there's a classy way to do this.
There is.
Whoa, why are you flinching? There's a classy way to do this,
yeah,
Donnie.
You're not on the classy path right now. You have fallen
from
the...
Okay, I can do two things. I can either have the car go...
Nope. Because let's just say that hits a car that causes an accident. Who do you think is going to be liable for that? HDNet.
There's no cars coming.
Oh, almost in the cab.
Sorry, that's the classy way to do it.
Just put a little simple syrup on a plate.
The first step to making the Cloudgate Martini is to pour simple syrup and flakes of real silver into saucers.
Hey, all right,
get it out there, though. Don't be shy about it.
Okay, is that enough?
Yes.
All right, so now we have...
Two glasses.
Here, I'm just going to roll.
Yeah. God, he's good.
Okay. And on this, I'm going to sort of...
Push it towards the perfect. I would hire you. I'll put it that way.
Really?
No, I would not.
Now we come to the drink part of it.
Yes. Okay.
All right, so here we go. First ingredient.
Cloudgate.
So how much goes in here?
3.5 ounces.
Next up, Grey Goose Le Poir and Triple Sec.
Give it a good shake. Then we're going to strain it into each one of these glasses.
Is that too strong, you think?
No, not at all. But I will tell you this. You know what you want to do when you shake?
What?
You want to try to swirl it against
so
the side of the mix.
Rotating?
Yes.
You don't want to just
put you've heard the term, like, bruising gin?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what you're trying to avoid here.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But you look silly.
Yeah, well, you suffer for your art.
That's
you
amazing.
Suffer for your art. Yeah, you're full.
Oh, I see. So I'm getting it. Yeah.
But you gotta go, there needs to be more up and down.
Higher?
Yeah, there you go.
Really? Yeah. If I go down, I guarantee I'm not gonna see your bartenders doing this.
Yeah, that's a bit extreme. That is a bit extreme. But you will see them doing like this.
Really?
Yeah.
We're gonna go spot check them.
They might not be.
Don't.
Now, the key is, can you get it to go into the glasses without getting the silver into the glass? Because that's
very unlikely.
That's a nightmare.
I'll do one. I'll try it. Should I do it one-handed?
I love that. That's very impressive with the one hand.
Well,
I'm impressed.
I'm nervous. Now, about the same as the other one?
Good, perfect. There you go.
Is that a high five happening? Yeah.
It was a point high five.
I haven't high five since the 80s, but I'll do it when one's deserved.
Why wouldn't you?
The last step is topping it off with some pricey champagne.
So this is the drink, but it's $200. So it obviously comes from what we like to say, a little something special from your favorite luxury jeweler.
What is this?
This is what every Cloud Gate is served with.
We hope your experience and this necklace provide you with great memories. We look forward to seeing you again.
I asked everybody what you would most like, and they said this.
And this looks a lot like the Cloud Gate behind us.
The Cloud Gate sculpture. This is the Elsa Peretti bean pendant. It is the only piece of jewelry that is allowed to resemble the Cloud Gate sculpture.
Really?
Yes.
Is this to celebrate our union?
In the animal kingdom, they call that presenting.
That's peacocking.
Yeah.
Don't make me laugh or it's gonna explode. Awesome. Thank you, Donnie.
Pleasure.
Now what happened over there as far as the...
What are you talking about?
From a roof with a beautiful view of the park, we headed to the smallest bar in Chicago, Matchbox. It's so small that you can sit at the bar and touch the back wall without moving. In honor of the smallest bar I've been in, I give you Drinking Made Easy's quickest cocktail, the Apricot Margarita. Rim a glass with lime and powdered sugar, make a long twist of lemon, throw on a lime wedge, add 4 ounces of apricot-infused tequila, and Cointreau to a shaker of ice. Then, to the shaker, add 1 ounce of fresh lemon juice, 1 ounce of fresh lime juice, a heaping teaspoon of powdered sugar, and some egg white. Shake it up, pour, and drink. Matchbox has some other great cocktails, but we have to split because we have an appointment at the Green Door.
During Prohibition, it became an Italian restaurant. Vito Giacomo opened up an Italian restaurant.
An Italian restaurant?
You can
basically?
Imagine. Okay. You can only imagine, right? It had a green door. The building physically had a green door on it, as it does today. And the green door was code for, we have a speakeasy, everything's good.
Okay.
The restaurant operated upstairs. This room is in the basement with a full bar, built during Prohibition, and this was a speakeasy. One way in, another way out in case something happened.
So basically, if there was a place that had a green door, it was sort of a wink, wink. We don't talk about it, but everybody knows and everybody's kind of taken care of.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how it happened in the rest of the world, but in Chicago,
people take care of things.
It's the city that works, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So this is the speakeasy from during the Prohibition era, and that's really a big part of our heritage here at the Green Door.
Yeah. And when you look at it, it's sort of like him after he's had a few drinks. It kind of just leans one way. There is a little bit of leaning.
There's probably about a 2 foot lean in the building.
Wow.
It's very noticeable.
So what does it lean?
The stairs are like walking up through a fun house.
I thought it was me. We're going to have some Prohibition era cocktails, right?
Right.
Lou's about to show me how to make a popular Prohibition era drink, the French 75. It's made with 2 ounces of gin.
Grab the lemon juice down there.
1 ounce of lemon juice and 1 ounce of simple syrup. During Prohibition, the liquor was often of such low quality that they hid it with other flavors. So this drink is full of sugar and topped off with champagne.
All right,
you ready?
75.
All right. It's like a modified gin and tonic, kind of.
Yeah. That's pretty good.
Yeah. You know, these guys fought in World War I and then came back home and they invented this high-powered drink named after the French 75, which is a high-powered piece of artillery that we would have used
with France or France would use with
That's right.
The French 75 was basically a cannon on wheels.
Right.
That didn't look harmless. That looked like
right.
A
and again, it had enough of the lemon juice and the champagne and the simple syrup to disguise that flavor that we were talking about earlier of the liquors that may or may not have tasted that great.
It's like taking maybe like a patch of flowers and hiding the gun inside of it.
It's, I like
what
that.
What seems gentle and pretty from the outside will actually destroy you. Thanks, Lou.
You're
I had
welcome.
A good time.
Thank you.
How do I exit? Can I go through upstairs?
Or we can head right out the back door here, okay. If you like. But if you don't mind, I'd like to clean up a couple things. If you don't
just
mind.
Do some work around the bar.
Okay.
Take care.
Sorry. All right. Thanks, Lou.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, America's favorite pastime: beer and baseball. We're in Chicago, where they're known for their thick pizzas. So I popped into Giordano's to make Steve and I two pies that we'd race to eat later. Each of these nearly 5-pound beauties starts off with a buttered deep dish pan, pizza dough, cheese, and toppings. It's then topped off with more dough, sauce, and Parmesan cheese. In Chicago, they love pizza and drinking almost as much as they love their sports teams. So while the pizza's baked in the oven, we went to Skybox on Sheffield to catch a Cubs game and drink some local Goose Island beer.
This building used to be an apartment building?
Yeah, just an apartment building. 3 stories of apartments.
And people would come to the roof and watch the game?
So then from the top floor, you can actually see into the game from the window. So just made the decision that we invite some people over. Maybe give them a, you know, charge a little bit,
and then
you know, offer them
starts
some,
to grow and
yeah,
grow.
Some beer and some drinks.
Are you guys affiliated with the Cubs?
Yeah, we have a relationship with the Cubs. We have a revenue share, which allows us to have the unrestricted, view of the
It
people.
Basically makes it so they don't build a wall right there.
Right, which would be very bad for our business.
Yes.
Yeah.
So now we have several rooftops that have different, how many are there? About like 20?
16. There are 16 total. Okay. Everyone's kind of got their own view. They've got their own little niche, kind of their flavor of Chicago or their flavor of the game. Yeah.
And how many fit in your guys' thing?
200. We fit 200.
Really? 200 people?
200 people.
This is a popular one, the 312.
It is. That's the Chicago area code. If you see the tap handle, it's a phone receiver. So the antique phone receiver, 312. A lot of people mess it up. Give me a 1-2-3, 312, whatever, 312.
This is your most popular beer, correct?
This is our flagship beer. It's a Chicago area code, very popular in Chicago. What's great about this beer is this is the beer that gets people to try craft beer. Everybody who thinks craft beer is too strong, too dark, too bitter, they'll taste this and go, wow.
Okay.
And it gets them started drinking better beer. And it's very local. You go into a bar, you'll see our tap handle. It's a vintage phone receiver. It's unmistakable.
Skybox on Sheffield hasn't always had an affiliation with Goose Island, right? I mean, you guys started off.
No, this is new this year.
Okay.
It's all part of our desire to kind of bring a lot more of Chicago to every game.
Okay.
So it's that celebration of Chicago from, you know, obviously got the view of the stadium and everything.
We got the guy on the buckets.
That's you got the bucket guy.
Yeah, that's very,
we've got
every,
the food,
every city.
We got the drinks. Yeah. We got a little bit of everything now. Yeah.
So all the food, the beverages, and then this is Chicago. You have the skyline right over there. You have the L right behind
the L,
us.
Yep. You got everything.
You guys, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
You guys enjoy the game. I have to go and drink. It's my job. I have to. Come on, Steve. Let's go.
While we were drinking Goose Island at the game, Mark was drinking it at the source. He went to Goose Island Brewery to talk about their Bourbon County Stout.
Starting in 1992, our brewmaster, Greg Hall, wanted to do a specific blend of American and distinctly English. So we wanted to blend the two cultures together.
This beer is aged in used oak barrels. During the process, it takes on some of the flavors of the bourbon and the barrel.
You got some right there?
Yeah, definitely. Let's try some.
This is made here at Goose Island in Chicago, and it's confusing to me a little bit because I hear bourbon and I think bourbon.
Yeah.
Okay. So the barrels that you get, they're always from the same place?
Generally, our barrels for this beer are 10 to 16-year-old Heaven Hills bourbon barrels.
Okay, so you do like a consistent...
Yeah.
Because it affects the flavor of the beer.
It affects the taste. Depending on what bourbon you use, depending on how old the barrels are, you get different flavors out.
So if you use like a really young barrel, that'll affect the flavor of the beer.
Yeah, it'll be a little hotter, a little more alcoholic, not as refined. These ones we find give us a good alcohol character, a good bourbon character, but still impart the charcoal flavor from the wood, as well as the vanilla, coconut, cherry from the wood as well. Bourbon barrels have to be charred on the inside. We get the barrels straight from the distillery. They're rinsed there. We put our beer into them, age them about a year, pull it out, and there you go.
What makes it so dark?
The malts we use. So you remember you tasted that chocolate malt?
Yeah.
So we use even darker malts than that.
How strong is this?
This is about 13.5% alcohol.
What happens if you drink? This is a big bottle, dude.
It's a big bottle.
Are you able to drink one of these?
I have yet drink one full one in one sitting. They usually share. They're for sharing.
You have a good job.
I have a great job.
So if you come to Chicago, check out their bar and try some of these beers. They're amazing. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Cheers.
Back at Giordano's, our pizzas were ready. And since Steve hasn't been doing so well in his eating challenges, I decided to step in and show him how it's done.
I know you and your sneaky tricks, so you can't, like, start a second one. Well, I've done this with you before, dude. I know how you do it. You're all sneaky.
What are you? You'll shovel some under the table?
No, you just, like, mix it up and go, okay, that's one, and then you'll have another one.
Are we starting?
Yeah.
Steve keeps up with me after the first slice.
Don't choke on the cheese. Oh.
Three, one, two.
Yeah. Hitting a wall. Sets in quick, huh?
Yeah. It's like there's a lot happening in my stomach right now.
Wow.
So I've been informed that these little innocent-looking pizzas actually weigh about 6 pounds.
After three slices of stuffed pizza,
whatever you want,
we're still neck and neck.
Four.
I can't.
You can't what?
I can't believe we're still eating.
Uh-huh.
Why do you have to come up with these stupid ideas?
What else were we gonna eat in Chicago? By the way, remember in the beginning when I was talking about how the fact that you just mess up your stuff to make it look like you're eating? How's that strategic?
Now I don't want to eat any of it. What's wrong
with I move on to the fifth slice, Steve hits his roadblock.
Maybe this is why you have 50,000 Twitter fans and I have two.
I'll be part of it.
If I finish this nearly 6 pound pizza, I'll be the first person on record to have done it.
Let's do it! Yeah! No, whoa.
What?
No, you gotta finish this on your plate.
You sound like my mom.
Hey, you know what? No one said it was gonna be easy. The owner is actually standing right there. Look how close she's actually standing. So we couldn't fake it. I feel like I made room. I wish that, like, eating a lot of food made you drunk so that it would at least be fun. Right. You know what I mean? Like, oh my God, I do. How much have you eaten today? I like a whole pizza, dude.
Does your belly hurt?
Oh my God, I'm so much pain. Are you okay, Steve? Steve, if you come in and do this, do the cheese first. That's the hardest part.
More fun.
Oh. Uh-oh. What was that?
That was a gag reflex. And all
that sauce. Yeah, I know.
She's a stickler.
I know.
I guess I have one more piece. One more for the roadblock, huh?
I'm about to put this one to bed. 6 pounds. You know what they say around my house? You make it, you eat it.
Six pounds of pizza and 3 pints of beer, that's called bringing the heat Chicago style.
Good job, buddy. You can at least chug that beer of yours.